Thank you. Good morning. So the following will be on the exam this afternoon. Learning drives the bus, educator as empiricist, and useful and usable technology. Those are going to be on there for sure. Everything else you're going to have to pay attention to. I wanted to ask who did their homework last night. Okay, so we have a couple folks who went to Khan and did their homework. What kinds of experience did you have? That's a good start. Because I had the same experience. I forgot how much I had forgotten about math over the years. So it's kind of nice to go and refresh a little bit like that sometimes. You can always go and do a makeup later over the weekend. I'm going to give credit until Monday morning for that. So if somebody does decide they want to do that as makeup, come see me on Monday morning and then I could check you off and put you in the grade book. So today we're going to focus on the process. Yesterday I talked a lot about product. What are you going to do when you're trying to evaluate vendors? Today I want to talk about what should you think about when you're trying to implement it. So after you make a decision, or even as part of that decision-making process. These are the major categories that I'll cover. Since learning drives the bus, I'm going to start with pedagogy, and then we'll work through the supporting areas, ending with evaluation. Some people might even start with evaluation. Yesterday, I started with evaluation just to give you a little bit of a sense of what you should be thinking about in terms of outcomes. Today, I'll end on that so you'll be able to tie it all back together. So we have a variety of different methodologies, and we employ all different techniques to utilize the systems. In the lecture model, for example, you can use adaptive systems for homework and assessment. So if you don't have total control over transforming your course and you're working with some constraints, don't feel like it's impossible to use an adaptive technology. We heard yesterday from some of the vendor presentations, they actually encourage you to use it as a supplement to your lecture. So there are many ways to use this material. Another way in the flipped model is to actually do what we've done on ours, and that is transform the experience. So all of the lecture and instructional material is in the adaptive system, and then do assessment as well. Another one, online, you may have to do everything through an adaptive system. So as you think about your situation, put this in context for your needs. It's a spectrum. It's not all or nothing or either or. It's a fit. So you're trying to find that perfect fit for your needs. There may be other models. So again, today if you have suggestions or questions along the way, raise your hands and we'll dive in. So when we think about the approach to using adaptive systems, one of the first questions is, what are we going to do with the approach, the pedagogical approach? Is it going to be a self-paced model? In math, as I showed yesterday, self-paced can be the perfect fit. For students that have 12 years of math background, maybe they slept through a couple of them, but they should have been exposed to math for 12 years, they've got somewhere to start. In other disciplines, it may not work that way. So you have to ask yourself, what type of approach are we going to use? I'll talk about the synced model as an alternative to self-paced because that fits for us the other disciplines much better. And by synced, I mean during a week, all the students are focused on the same concept. There's adaptive activity around the learning process, but they're all in the same spot. So they're synced up intellectually around studying DNA, for example, or studying bases and acids in chemistry. On the self-paced side, students can take the exam when they're ready. This is the mastery model, and we hear more and more about this. I like the mastery model for areas where students have some background, and maybe upper division students could be served, third year, fourth year. Master's degree students can be served in this way also. If they have good, strong backgrounds, you might as well move them forward, keep them going, let them take the exam. If they need help, then they can follow more of a curriculum that you've laid out. The problem there is managing that. It becomes an administrative nightmare if you're trying to give 100 different exam dates to 100 different students in a class. So in math, we've had to think about how do we facilitate the exam experience so that it doesn't overwhelm the professor? We use exam centers, so we'll tell the students, take it when you're ready, but you'll go to the exam center, you'll schedule a time, and you'll log in, and they'll give you a password, and you'll get access to the exam so you can take it online. So you have to think through all of the implications of going to that kind of self-paced model. If the students say, I'm ready to take the exam the first week, and the instructor doesn't have any infrastructure, then that disrupts the class because they have to take time out to proctor that student or set up a special case. So especially for the instructional designers and the support personnel in the room, you have to think ahead to build the infrastructure for the professors. On the self-paced side, they can work independently, and you're able to encourage them to move ahead or to remediate as needed. But on the sync side, what we're trying to do is encourage interactivity around that concept. So that's where we go for depth as opposed to speed. So if I'm racing through a curriculum because I've had it before and I understand most of it, that's fine. But in the sync model, what we're asking the students to go deeper, to think harder, to use the higher order thinking skills, do problem solving. And then finally, how do you measure this? If you're measuring a self-paced on mastery or competency, on the other side, we use more of a traditional model. They completed the course. They were able to pass the exam successfully. They were able to demonstrate their understanding of the material. So thinking about where it starts is important because those are all first order decisions. Before you start to dig into all the technology issues and the facilities issues and other things, if the faculty members don't have clarity on how they want to structure the pedagogy and the curriculum, then along the way you will stumble across these decisions. You'll find yourself three quarters of the way through thinking, we didn't think about that strategically, and now we have to go back and redesign some aspect of the course. So try to play out the whole course in your head, looking at these different models, and then you can try, and it's almost like a scenario-based analysis. Try to think about if you were a student in week 12 of a semester and you were already done with everything, could you take the final? And how would you take the final? And where would you go to take the final? And who would organize that experience for you? So we've tried a little bit of everything along the way. First thing we tried was online and self-paced, and that was an absolute disaster. And it was primarily because students weren't ready. And they aren't capable, I don't think, necessarily at 18 years old of managing their time in an effective way, and we know from experience that they will procrastinate when given the chance. So that's what they did. They ran through first 14 weeks of a self-paced course and did virtually nothing, and then tried to cram it all in the last 2 weeks and fell apart. So we picked up the pieces, we laid them all out on the table and said, how are we going to do better? And the way we do better is to do what we call the flipped and self-paced, where, and you've seen this in Emporium model, Virginia Tech has a pretty famous model, you see it in others, Austin Community College has a new center. So we make them come to class. In math, it's 3 times a week. In other disciplines, 1 or 2 times a week. But we want to see them in class where we can do the kinds of interventions they need, supervised study, so to speak. And then we flood the classroom with support. So we'll have a faculty member. We'll have teaching assistants. We'll have undergraduate assistants. We have supplemental instruction. We have tutors. So people around to help out as they need it. And that gives them confidence, it also gives them encouragement and pressure. Because we need to put pressure on them to keep the pace. If we tell them, you have to do, in Alex, for example, 6 topics and 60 minutes of math every day, the faculty can look at that and check every evening, did the student spend 60 minutes in Alex, or did they complete 6 topics? And the next day, they can address that. If they aren't doing that, then you can encourage them or put pressure in some way. The best instructor that we had had a 90% success rate in her college algebra class, and she was so diligent about that. Every day there would be an email to the students who didn't do that. She would be looking after them. It's a little intense if you're not accustomed to it, but she had set up a system. She had about 120 students in her section, so she set up a system that allowed her to identify the students that needed a nudge, And then she would just keep doing that. And she succeeded in pushing through the class. And that's our goal, is to build that kind of infrastructure. Now, and the other one we tried is the flipped and synced. And this is also the chemistry, physics, biology model. So for us, those are the pieces that evolved. Yep, question?
I don't mean to interrupt. But the question is, as a faculty member, I just know managing a large course online self-paced is what I would consider a nightmare.
Yes.
Because the students can come from all over the world, time zones, you, et cetera, et cetera. So is there some sort of platform that actually addresses the faculty instead of the student trying to manage that same system?
So the ones that are more mature, like the Alex platform and the MyMathLab platform, do a better job of that because they have better reporting infrastructure so that you can keep track. But that is the challenge right now, and that's one of the areas the vendors need to improve for the vendors in the room. As a faculty member becomes more and more dependent on the technology for that type of tracking and intervention, the reporting has to get better. We struggle with the volume issue. I call it the scale, the curse of scale. You might have 400 students in an online section. These are typical in our, how many? 1,500, so even more. We would break that down at Arizona State, so we would have multiple instructors for that many students, but we might give them 200 or 250. And keeping track is a really difficult process. So the reporting's critical. And then the extension of that, how do you email those students in mass? So if you identify the list of the 50 students that need attention today, how can I hit send and email them some update? Critical issue for every faculty member. And even in the smaller classes, even when we're dealing with 75 students in a class, you can get lost. I kind of have a feeling that 75 is about the level of reasonable management for getting to know the students based on our experience. That's sort of our threshold. When you get to 100, 150, 200, then you can't keep track of all the people and all the faces. So we've got it like right at about 75 as a safe level. The model that we get the best success from looks like this. And the way we've come to this, as I mentioned, has been an evolution. What we found is the proper tool for the proper task to get the best results. The adaptive learning systems can deliver on the base of Bloom's taxonomy. How many are familiar with Bloom's taxonomy? This is pretty typical now. That's good. This is where adaptive courseware excels and where we get the most value out of it. What we've done is we've taken all of the lectures, we videotaped them, we put them into the adaptive system, taking all the text from textbooks, all of the assessment questions, all of the other material, exercises, interactive tools, put them all in the adaptive system. Students are expected to do all of that before they come to class. And we use various incentives, one being 20% of their grade is based upon the work they do in the adaptive courseware. And then when they get to class, we're going to do additional things, new things. We have a technique we call the applied concept exercise, and the ACE is a problem-solving process that we use to engage students in small group problem-solving. It's very comparable to what most of us are doing with our colleagues at work in an office conference room where we've got a whiteboard and display screen and somebody's plugged in and everybody's trying to solve the problem that we're confronted with. So we think that freshmen can be exposed to that technique and should be exposed to that technique because we want to prepare them for next generation workplace. We know that that's what they're going to be doing, working in small groups, solving problems, collaborating, communicating, and in that model, we think that's the most valuable activity. And by we, I'm talking about the faculty. The faculty feel like that's the most valuable activity that they can do with the students while they're in class. The way it works in practice is a cycle that helps us create these in a relatively efficient manner. When I think about how complicated it is to take a course apart and then rebuild it. This process helps us connect the faculty members to the construction of the new course. Information acquisition is in the adaptive system now. The experience we've had with this is if you're trying to ride multiple systems, we had Blackboard and another system, or Canvas and another system, and you have instructional materials in a variety of places, students can get lost in the maze. They don't know which video goes with which homework, goes with which reading. So the closer you can get to full integration, the stronger the curriculum will be. That's where we've made a breakthrough with some of the new vendors when we're working with Acrobatic or Cogbooks or some of the ones that are more platform-oriented. They allow us to put everything in there, and that gives the students a single place to find all that information. Next, we want them to do something with that. So this is where they get graded. And typically, this is in a form of a quiz or maybe a writing assignment in some cases. But there is a process of proof in that where we get a first look at whether they understood it or not. In biology, Sunday night at midnight, students have to complete the lesson for that week. So that might be between 4 and 8 quizzes over a set of maybe 5 different readings and 5 or 6 videos. They take all those quizzes by Sunday night, so they have between Wednesday of the previous week and Sunday night. Most of them wait till Sunday night at about 11 o'clock and then storm the gates and try to get it all done. But they have to do it because Monday morning, the professor comes in, opens up the dashboard, and this goes to managing large volumes of students. She has 450 students. She sees right away the most difficult problems. These are the areas students struggled with. So in a very practical way, that's what do I need to focus on today when they come to their first review session, because we have the review session on Monday afternoon. And then she builds a PowerPoint slide that has the top 5 questions the students got wrong. This is a review session, so this is the traditional lecture model. She gets up, she talks about the misunderstandings that were most common for most of the students. She clarifies the concepts. She may put some supporting material behind that. She has 75 minutes, so she can cover a lot of ground. She may also do some clicker questions. So she's engaging with the students in a large lecture hall. And then she's setting them up for the remainder of the week, because on Tuesday or Thursday, they will come in for their active learning session. And that's the next piece of the puzzle. This is where they do the problem solving, and they get the ACE. They'll do a pre-reading, and it's often a popular article that's associated with the concept. If we're doing, let's see, a good example of this is they do an example of forensics, and they talk about DNA. So there'll be an article from The Economist or some other publication about the accuracy of DNA, something to get them primed for the conversation. Then when they come in to the class, they are placed on a jury. They're told, we have an assault, and we have an eyewitness, and there's evidence from the case, and you're a juror, and do you believe the eyewitness? So they vote with their clicker. Yeah, the eyewitness is good. We believe the eyewitness. And then we introduce additional information. And they are sitting in a round table with 5 other peers, and they have a whiteboard, and we're asking them to process the scientific information. So what if we have DNA evidence? What will you be looking for in the DNA evidence? And they go through their analysis, and they make a list, and then the professor debriefs with the whole group, and then they're assigned their next activity. What if we add in some other type of evidence? So as they get into this, they're applying the scientific method. They're having a very robust debate. I like to call it controlled chaos, because the room explodes with energy. The students jump up and start writing on the whiteboard and arguing with each other about what they can and cannot trust in the evidence. All of these tasks are trying to develop that 21st century skill set that we sometimes take for granted. If we've been in an environment for 15 or 20 years, we get used to, we get acculturated to doing this. What we want to do is we want to jumpstart that process. And we bound the problem appropriately so they don't get overwhelmed. We're not going to ask them to do a scientific analysis that would be the equivalent of a student who's in genetics and is studying biology in their senior year. We're going to give them enough information that they understand how to apply it. And we want it to be an emotional experience. One of the things that is very important for the overall pedagogical approach here is that we want something they will remember in 10 years or 15 years about biology. Something that they will think about when they're on a jury or when they're watching CSI and they see somebody talk about forensic evidence and then they could say, that's BS. I said, that's not the way it works. There needs to be some context. What's the emotional hook? We put them on a jury because that's the emotional hook. When we do infectious diseases, we ask them if they would vaccinate themselves against the disease. And that's the first question. And then we work through the issues. What about autism? Is there a direct link between vaccination and autism? And we provide all the scientific data. They go through the analysis. They have a debate about that. These are the issues that they're going to encounter almost right away in their life. Every fall, everybody's getting encouraged to get vaccinated against the flu. And then it's Ebola. And then it's Zika. And then it's measles at Disney. And then it's something else. It's the gift that keeps giving for us. Every semester, there's another case of viral infection, meningitis. So every student is getting exposed to the emotional challenges of processing scientific data almost on a daily basis. They just don't know it. So what we're doing is we're scaffolding them up using the active learning and the adaptive system so that they are prepared as much as possible within the time and curricular constraints we have to do those kinds of analyses. And then finally, we try to create some type of assimilation where we summarize and wrap up. We want them to write an essay. They may have to do some type of group debrief with their classmates. They will work in their team for the first 8 weeks, and then we shuffle the room based upon the results of their second exam because we want them to get used to that process as well. You get comfortable. So first day they come and they sit down and they start talking, they get to know each other, they make friends, they build a social network, they start to engage with people from other disciplines, they identify common interests, they get comfortable, and then we break it all up. We put them with other people, they complain and they worry and they hem and they haw, and then they get used to each other again, they develop new friendships and they develop new working relationships. That's all part of a natural process as well. So from the student standpoint, what this does, and I mentioned this in our data set yesterday, is build a safety net underneath of them so that when the going gets tough, and it will get tough in week 8, 9, 10, 11, when they're getting into the more scientific material, they have somebody to call on. They have a friend or a teaching assistant or somebody in that room that they can connect with. It's not just them and 300 strangers listening to an instructor that they're afraid to approach, even though the instructor has office hours every week and nobody comes. So we're breaking down all of those barriers, putting them into this environment that's more akin to a professional working environment. We think that we are giving them a higher chance of success, and as I mentioned yesterday, we know it's having a beneficial effect on keeping them in class, so they're not withdrawing from that course at such a high rate. So this is how it looks in practice across the semester. This is just a made-up course. This isn't the actual curriculum. We do the same kind of problem solving. After the first week, they're accustomed to it. We actually start them off with an exercise. It's a Jedi mind trick that a professor in New Mexico developed. He was having trouble getting students to participate in his active learning classes. And he was so frustrated year after year after year, he couldn't figure out what to do. He would browbeat them and try to convince them that active learning was in their best interest, and they would just sit back and fold their hands and listen. Because they've been told to sit down and shut up for 12 years. So now we're telling them, stand up and talk. Grab the pen, get up at the whiteboard, start sharing your ideas. They're not comfortable with that at all. So his Jedi mind trick boiled down to three questions, and I can share this with the group. He published a short paper, it's just 3 pages long. The questions are basically, for the students, and these clickers, he asks them, what are the different priorities you have for learning? Do you want to read the material outside of class, listen to the lectures in class, do group work, and he gets them to commit to that. And then he asks them, what's the best place to do that? Is it in class or out of class? And he uses the clickers again, and he gets them to commit to that. And by the time they're done with the third question, which is, and what's the most valuable way to spend our time together? They're all voting for active learning. He's basically gotten them all to climb that learning curve in a very short period of time. And I found that fascinating. I said, let's do it. So we do that on all of our first day exercises and all of our adaptive and active classes. And the faculty love it because it solves their frustration with students who don't want to participate. So I have a video that I want to show you now, and I was inspired by Tom's video yesterday, that is something that is similar to that, but I did it for the same reason. Go down and find it. That faculty were troubled by students who were not.
Welcome to Bio 100, the living world. In this video, I'll give you an overview.
Let me give
Welcome
you one other.
Welcome to Bio 100, the living world. In this video, I'll give you an overview of the course.
Let me do one other setup before I start that. I used to hear from the faculty that I work with that students would complain for the first 2 or 3 weeks of class. I can't figure out how to use the system. I don't know what you want me to do. You're not lecturing. You're not teaching me. And the litany of complaints was great. We would get even emails to the president of the university saying, you're cheating me because you're not lecturing to me. I want to be lectured to. You must lecture to me. These are very valid concerns. Students think that if you're not lecturing, they're not learning. So after listening to this for about 2 years, I said, we need to think about a way to address this. Students don't, they don't know the word pedagogy. They have no learning science structure to build on. What can we do to introduce them to learning science and pedagogy and not threaten them or not overwhelm them? And the answer was this video. It's a tool that you can use to do your own kind of homemade videos. And it's a simple narrative, and the idea is to get them up the learning curve of transformation from listener to active learner in as short a period of time as possible. So that's the setup for this.
The living world. In this video, I'll give you an overview of the course, a tech tour, and some tips to help you succeed. This class may be different from those you've taken before. It's a unique combination of adaptive learning systems and applied concept exercises we've created to help you learn biology. First, all of the lessons are online in the Cogbook system. You can watch the videos whenever, wherever, and as many times as you want. Take notes just like you would in class so you'll be able to review them for your exams. Second, Cogbooks also provides personalized study recommendations to help you learn. They use advanced algorithms to analyze your work and recommend which materials you might want to study more. Third, in class, you're expected to actively participate in the discussions with your classmates. We've designed the applied concept exercises to help you understand how science affects your life and can help you make good decisions in the future. Now I'm going to switch to the tech tour so you'll know how the system works and what tools are available to help you learn.
So that's all they need to know about pedagogy. And that alone was sufficient to end the barrage of questions that we were getting. There's a 3 minutes of tech tour after that where we walk them through the system and say, click here, click here, click here, so that they get a feel for what they're going to be doing with the adaptive system. Combination of those two elements silenced all of those emails. And the faculty came to me 4 weeks into the semester and said, what did you do? I said, I just did a little video. I just did a little intro. And they went, solve the problem. So that's the piece that we use in addition to this Jedi mind trick in class to get them up that learning curve. We're cognizant of the fact that every semester, the students have to climb that curve. It's a new cohort. They have no concept of what we're doing or why we're doing it. So that's part of that prologue. Material. We want it in there, and or not prologue, but the preface for the course. And we think that as part of the approach, the combination of those two activities is doing a good job for us. So the kicker there is that these two components, the pedagogy and the technology, are symbiotic. You have to think about it holistically. They are part of the same ecosystem. And if you don't treat them as interrelated, then you'll feel frustrated if it's not doing what you expected it to do, because the system has to flex at all levels. It's not just, I need a technology to solve my problem. I want to shift a little bit more technical now, talk about details within the system. For people who are systems oriented, UX is user experience. So we've got student user experience and instructor user experience. Most of the time when we evaluate systems, we focus on those because those are the things that we see. People say, oh, I see it. I can understand how to use it. This is the way it works. I prefer to focus on the bottom two, content curation and course creation, because that's where the work gets done. That's where the faculty have to decide what's going to happen to get to the student user experience. So as you think about different pieces of the system when you're talking to the vendors, these bottom two are key questions that you'll want to address with them. And I'll dig into some details on these a little bit more. In between the information architecture and the database structure may be relevant for you. If you're more technically inclined, you may want to ask questions about that. But I think you can sort of get a feel for it if you lay your hands on the systems and actually load up some content or set up a course, so you get a better understanding of what's happening as you go through that process. The first big decision is, do you create something or do you just configure it? We heard a little bit of that yesterday. The construction process is the one that most people think about. They think, I'm going to build an adaptive system, but it's very time consuming. If you're going to start from scratch, you have to have realistic expectations. You're going to need to spend time or hire graduate assistants, as we saw yesterday, and get people involved, have instructional designers, all the support that you need. Configuration is much quicker. And in the case of Alex, for example, or MyMathLab, they give you checklists. You go through and you select the lessons that you want, and the system configures the curriculum for you. To get flexibility on construction, that's what everybody wants. It's my class, my curriculum, it's my video, it's my text, it's my assessment questions, and I want to put them all together into my course. That's great, and that's what we've done in physics, what we've done in chemistry and biology, but be prepared for the investment in that, because that's where the costs add up. That's where it is expensive to have a faculty member not doing research because they have to build a course, or not going after the next grant, or not doing the service activity because they're involved in development. I liken this to a textbook. If you're going to author a textbook, you have to think about that for as an 18 or 24 month commitment, maybe even longer, maybe a lifetime commitment if it's a good textbook and it's a bestseller. It just keeps coming back and getting revised. So it's a long-term commitment. Configuration's much cheaper and much safer. If somebody else is managing that infrastructure, then they're responsible for making sure all of the pieces are working. When you build it yourself and you construct something from scratch, all those student emails that come in week two when things aren't going well are going to go right to the professor. They're going to fall right on top of the support staff. And it's a very crushing situation when you realize that something's not working and 450 or 1,500 students are depending on you to educate them. So think seriously about the commitment before committing to that process. I'll talk more about the details here, examples of what we did with course creation. This was the first course we ever did as an adaptive course in 2011. We spent 9 months with Newton building a developmental math course. It was fully customized. Our faculty went in and did videos and built out all of the instructional materials for that math course. Had to do the entire knowledge graph, probably thousands of hours of faculty time. We bought out 4 or 5 math faculty members, and we had lots of staff people. It was one of those moments when everybody was excited and nobody cared about the cost, and very rare moment. We then switched over to a product from Pearson, which is my math lab. It took about 9 days to figure out what we were going to do. It's a series of decisions that the math faculty knew right away what to do with. These are checkboxes. So do you want to teach functions? Do you want to determine whether a relation represents a function? Yes, check the box. Pearson does all the configuration. Now there are debates, raucous debates, about whether to check that box or not. And I think that's healthy. That's actually what the value the faculty add is, making that decision. And then there's all the collateral material. What are we going to do to support that? How are we going to build our exam? How are we going to build our quizzes? So this is just the first decision. But the difference between 9 months and thousands of hours and 9 days and a committee of 5 or 6 faculty members is a dramatic difference. When we did another transformation, we went to Alex recently, starting in fall of last year, and that process took us some time also to learn the Alex product and then get that set up, but nothing like building it ourselves. The market is moving in this direction. So you're seeing modularity as a new byproduct of all of these conversations. We want to be able to plug and play. We want to do these modules. Plus, I have, as a faculty member, I'm interested in teaching 2 more things. I want to be able to add those in to the curriculum. So getting to a point where you have starter material and then you can build on that is critical. When you're talking to the vendors, ask them, do you have any starter material? How much of that can I edit? How much of that can I change? In the case of Alex, we can take stuff away, but we can't add anything. So that's a huge limitation. If there's a lesson missing, we have to go through their whole development process. It goes into the queue, it rises to the top, the Alex staff build it, goes through testing, and then it gets added to the product. So as you think about that, what are your levels of tolerance for their product availability or their flexibility? So course creation by subject matter, the math model is the assess, learn, assess approach. The 2 people who did the Khan Academy last night, you see it's a constant drill. You're doing math, doing math, doing math, and they're assessing, assessing, assessing. And then if you need learning, you go and click on a link and Sal Khan comes up and does a little demonstration of the problem for you. Or you can read a little bit of text about the context of that problem. But the primary driver on that is assessment. Be careful with that, because the myth is that that is the norm, and it's not the norm. It is the exception, because it's much more common that students expect to learn first, then be assessed, and then go back through remediation, and then more learning and assessment. This is where we stumbled mightily. In a psychology course, we had been working on math for 3 years, and we started to expand to different disciplines, and we said, let's do psychology. That's a huge course, 5,500 students, lots and lots of instructors. We wanted to do something that we could scale. So we thought, well, let's take the math model and let's apply it. We put all these questions in there. Let's try to assess what they know about psychology. And they knew nothing about psychology. So the first day I was in class, and we're watching the students work on the system, and they're going through their first module, and hands start going up. I'm not getting any instructional materials. I'm just getting questions. They're on question 19, 20, 21. They're getting them all wrong because they know nothing about psychology. Maybe they're guessing and they're getting 1 or 2 of them right. But the problem was the model was broken. And the students discovered it right away. So we just had to just cash it in right there. The faculty member said, we're not going to use the system. We built it wrong. We're just going to toss it, and he's going to improvise. So he went into improvisational mode, and good thing he was a tenured faculty member who had lots and lots of experience in the classroom, so he was able to succeed that semester. But we went in with our eyes wide open for the redesign, and we said we need to think more about the sequence of student experience. And that's where we learned that you can't apply math to every discipline. So be careful when people say, we're going to do a pretest. On what? What does the student know about this discipline? What do you expect them to know? Maybe if they're upper division or a graduate student, a pretest will be meaningful because you're trying to figure out what did you learn in the 4 years leading up to this. But when you're dealing with general education, as we are, it's just a lost cause. So think about that. Be careful. Don't fall into the same trap that we fell into on course creation. And then the logic doesn't always apply. And in some cases, the rapid remediation using assessments is the most effective. In other cases, it's something where more of an algorithmic process will be useful. Content curation, this is where we live and breathe, because the instructional materials are the heart and soul of the courses. And if you cannot put your heart into that course and you have to accept everything that the vendor is giving you as is with no modification, it's going to lead to some frustration at some level. It's going to be faculty members who say, I can't actually see myself in this course. Where's the instruction? Where's the University of Florida aspect to this? So when you're buying stuff off the shelf and the vendors tell you, we have a pre-built course, are you willing to accept that? Now, most courses are willing to accept a textbook as it's written in its entirety. But that's only predicated on the fact that we have all these other learning activities around the course. We have lectures, or we have outside homework, and we write our own assessments. And so the book is just one component of it. But with the adaptive system, you're placing that at the center of the student experience. So if you cannot do anything with that material, you're going to get frustrated, and the faculty are going to be frustrated. The other side is, if the faculty do have content, and they have built their own book or their own reading material, their own homeworks, how do they get into the system? Everyone likes OER because it gives you flexibility, but if the vendor won't allow you to place it in the system, then you get this fragmentation I was talking about earlier, and you end up with all your material in Canvas and all of the adaptive material in some other system. Where we found OER to be helpful was in U.S. history. We had a faculty member who wanted to do two U.S. history courses. The OpenStax library had two good textbooks to start with, but she re-edited all that material and added material and crafted a book that was much closer to what she wanted to teach based upon the starter material. Then we loaded all of that up into Cogbooks, and we were able to embed her videos and get that material built out. So starter material, super valuable, because you don't want to reinvent the wheel, but you have to look at the vendor and say, how much of this can I get into their system? A lot of them are doing the walled garden model, which is, we paid an author to write a book, and it's in our system, and there's a wall around it, and you cannot do anything to that. You get the ebook locked down, you can't modify anything, it's an all or nothing deal. And the other model on the other side, you get a vendor like Acrobatic or some of the others that are wide open. You want to change something? That's what we're here for. Go in and realize it, same way. Go in there and change it, because it's an open public garden. So moving from that walled space to that public space is where the vendors are currently transforming their products. Alex is the first one that we've worked with that allows us to attach our videos to their lessons. Alex is this gigantic math machine, and they had a little button that said, I need help. And the students would click on that button, and they would have a book, one of the McGraw-Hill author's books, attached. And we said, we want to use one of our books. One of our faculty members wrote the OpenStax algebra book, Jay Abramson. And so we said, we want Jay's book, and we want our videos, because we have teaching assistants who do little 3-minute primers on the various problem-solving exercises, a la Sal Khan, for those who are familiar with that model. They do the whiteboarding and all that. So Alex said, okay. And for us, that was a revelation. That was the first time we'd ever been able to do that. So now we have their big machine and our custom content married together. We expect more and more of the publishers and the vendors to be doing that. And we're pushing the market that way. As you get involved in these conversations, I would expect you to also push in that direction, because I think that's the direction that the market has to go. There is a lot of space for sharing and a lot of space for collective improvement on these issues. So that's where we think that the future lies for content. Now, course development is the human side of this. This is the piece that requires a lot of personal attention, hand-holding, and work. I've had a lot of faculty members tell me, I've never gotten any support for course development. I was told when I came out with my PhD, you're teaching Chem 101, here's the syllabus, here's the book, here's the exam from last semester, good luck. And they just worked their way through it. And then they went to faculty development workshops, and they made their way through, and they learned how to use Canvas, and then they learned how to use Blackboard. And all along the way, they were on their own. They didn't have any life support. And now we come to them and we say, oh, guess what? We've got instructional designers. So they don't know how to work with instructional designers. They don't have any context for that. So we have to figure out, how do we work as a team? Because, by the way, we have technologists. There are people here who can solve the problem of how to load that video or help you make a video. And then we've got the vendor personnel. Every project I've worked on has a parallel vendor team. I'm a project manager, I've got instructional designers, I've got technologists, they've got a project manager, ID, technologist, and they may even have a subject matter expert, one of their other authors, on call to help out if we need them. There's also going to be graphic designers, people who help us figure out how to make it look pretty, organize the knowledge, organize it on the page, put it all together. We have 4 video studios at Arizona State, green screen studios. We produce television quality video. We've used a model we call the dialogue model. So we've got a professor and 2 students, and they pretend that they are on like a nightly talk show, and they talk their way through the lesson. So they'll present a little bit, and they'll ask the students questions. The students will ask them questions. What we did was we hired upper division students in those disciplines to pretend that they were freshmen, and they anticipate the questions that the freshmen might have. So we're modeling good behavior to the students on the videos. We also do just the voiceover videos, so they might just put their PowerPoint on and talk about it. We also do the monologue video where they're standing in front of a green screen and the images are over their shoulder. We also do skit videos, so if they tell us, the best way to learn this is to actually go out to a business and talk to a business owner about how they manage their inventory. We'll put a camera on somebody's shoulder, we'll go out and do that. Now, not every university has that infrastructure, so we've been fortunate to have built it over the last 10 years. But you have to think about that, because if you're going to start taking on responsibility for all the content, then those kinds of personal or professional experts are going to be very valuable. Librarians. So what about all the copyrights? What about all the intellectual property? Librarians are involved in the process. The team takes on a whole new meaning. The work is transformed. And then finally, leadership. I mentioned it yesterday when somebody asked about how do you actually get this done. 3 levels of leadership absolutely required to be successful at the provostial level, at the dean, and at the department chair level. At the department chair, I find that they are the ones who are under the most pressure to assign faculty, to manage the day-to-day operations, to get people where they need to be to support the learning process. That's a huge strain, and they often have to make snap decisions. Oh, we have to add another section because we ended up with another 100 students in algebra. Somebody has to be in that classroom when those students show up, so they have to go find a faculty member who's got time to teach that class. I empathize because I get the other side of that, which is, hey, Dale, we just had to reassign your faculty member you've been working with for a year to another class, and now we've got somebody new you have to work with. So I have to bring them up to speed as quickly as possible, with maybe a week before the class starts. And they have no exposure to active learning. They have no exposure to our adaptive system. That's the second learning curve. The student learning curve, we've mastered. But the faculty learning curve is a tougher one, because they're so busy with other things that if I tell them, stop everything and focus on this class, they say, I'm sorry, but that's not the way my life works. I've got research obligations, I've got committees, so we have to fit you in between all that to get ready for the class. So when you're working with faculty, it's a long-term development investment. And if the department chair doesn't support that, and the dean doesn't support that, then they're going to find reasons why they don't focus on the instructional or the adaptive development process. So get everybody lined up, make sure everybody supports it. And Then we also asked the department chairs to give the faculty some wiggle room to learn. Don't force a faculty member into an unsustainable situation where you're going to evaluate them based on their first semester in a brand new pedagogy with a brand new system. That could be a crushing blow for somebody who's on tenure track and suddenly their student evaluations nosedive because students don't respond well to them. They don't know how to manage chaos in the classroom. Give them a chance to breathe. I like to think it takes three times through a particular class before they develop a very high degree of expertise. So the second time they're teaching it, they start to get their sea legs. They understand how to deal with disruptive students or dysfunctional groups. They begin to understand and apply the techniques that help to manage that chaos. Third time through, they've got it all under control. They feel more comfortable than they ever did in lecture, and they actually thrive on that student energy. But if you don't set the expectation up front, then you might be setting the expectation for failure. You have to give them a chance. It's a team sport. If everybody doesn't understand that, then there's going to be a breakdown somewhere along the way. Make sure. Yep.
Do you have the data on the cost to benefit ratio of a team that size so that if we were to present it to a decision committee or whatever, we would have the data?
I have some costs on one of the last slides here for development. And okay. She was asking about the cost model, and that is the real bottom line, is there are upfront costs associated with this with the expectation that the results will benefit the students and the university. So we'll get to that. That's a great question. This is the faculty success model. Definitely strong departmental support and money. As I mentioned yesterday, I've been able to get some grant money to support this, but somewhere along the line, you're going to bump up against competing interests. If the faculty member just got an NSF grant worth $3 million, then you know they're going to commit to that for the next few years. They're not going to commit to doing your adaptive course. Let's be real. Let's not try to force something onto an organization that doesn't want to do it. So find out where that is. We use two faculty members for each course development process at a minimum. In math, sometimes we're at five or six because it's so big. We had 3,200 students in college algebra last fall. So the volume of work required more faculty members, but at least two, because they can balance each other out on the workload and also on the idea front so that they test ideas before they have to go before students and do it. We use peer mentoring for training. If we can get a faculty member to shadow another one who's already done it, then that accelerates the learning process there. And that's our on-ramp to this process. If we're able to get them in, we encourage faculty members to go to the active learning classes to see how they're being run. That helps a lot for them. And then this isn't for everyone. And I know that from experience. I'm comfortable working with crowds, but I know there are faculty members who need the command and control lecture environment to be successful and to do what they do best. So if it doesn't fit, then don't over stress the person. And I watch faculty members come in, try it out, not like it, and go do what they were doing before. That's fine. I really don't have a bias towards this. I think it works with the right faculty members, with the right support technology. But I also know there are plenty of other sections where lecture is just as appropriate. And most of the upper division courses, which are smaller in size, 40 or 50 students, lecture is just fine because you can interact with a crowd that size. It's a learning process. This is my three times through message. Patience is a virtue in this case, and for all the frustration to actually see it come together after 9 months or even sometimes 2 years of work is very rewarding, but you can't expect to turn something like this around in a month. And the success of the technology is always dependent on the teacher. If the teacher does not understand or value or work with the technology, then it's going to fail. It's always dependent upon the individual who's using it. Facilities is the one that is the most tricky because it's the one we control the least in all of these factors. And it's the one that can hamstring the best design at the end of the day. If you try to do active learning in that lecture hall, you're likely to be frustrated. There are very few faculty who can effectively manage interactions at that scale. And those are the brilliant ones who've mastered the art. What we need is we need time to build out these kinds of facilities. For us, very fortunately, very serendipitously, the library was going through a digitization process. So they were clearing their stacks and leaving large floor plates at the heart of the university open. So we got some money and we invested in rehabbing the library space as active learning studios. There are five factors here to think about: flat floor, round table, whiteboard, Wi-Fi, and audiovisual system. With those five factors, and you'll notice I did not say computers on the desks, because it's a bring your own computer now, bring your own device model, you can successfully change the experience for the students. University of Minnesota has a workshop coming up in August. If you're really interested in learning about how to do active learning and how to build out classroom spaces like this, I encourage you to go. We took six faculty members in 2013. They got to meet their peers, because it's more of a faculty conference where biologists from all over the country who do active learning show up, and chemists and physicists, and they get to talk to their peers and colleagues in their discipline. It was transformative. They all came back evangelical, because they all heard it firsthand, how it worked in physics, how it worked in math, how it worked in other disciplines. If you have that kind of commitment from the provost, send your lead faculty members there, get them into that conversation, build that community. Then they come back and they nurture the community here. So they can set off the same conversation. And you have a faculty development operation hosting us, thankfully, that can facilitate that kind of effort. Without that, the best case I can think of is University of Washington has a team in biology. Scott Freeman has published a number of articles about how he does active learning in the lecture model. And he spent a decade building new innovations into his course experience to increase the level of activity in the classroom. And he's published in Science magazine, so if you Google Scott Freeman, University of Washington, you'll see a whole bunch of really good ideas. If you don't have the time and the money to do that, then you can improvise. Yeah, Tom?
Just curious, what's the largest active learning space that ASU has been using? And have you found that there's sort of a point of diminishing returns when you reach a certain size, or you need to add TAs or something to
it? Yep. So 150 students in one space is the largest we have, but we find 75 to be manageable. 75 is 13 tables with 6 students each. It's actually 78 for those who are quick with the math. But it works because with 13 tables, you can get around the room. And we have 75-minute ACEs, so the faculty member can circulate. Then we flood the zone with support. We'll have a TA, a grad student TA. We'll have at least 2 IAs, which are instructional assistants. Those are undergrads. They'll either be from the major or from education. We find that education students who maybe want to teach physics in high school really want to get into the classroom and are really excited about this. So we can pay them $10 an hour and they'll come in, they'll walk the room and support the conversation. Because we're not talking about them as replacements for the faculty member, but they are stimulating the conversations. They're the eyes and ears on the ground in the room. So they may get 3 tables, and their job is to ask questions. Just keep probing. And if they see somebody who's not talking, ask that person a question. If they see someone who's talking too much, ask that person to be quiet and hand the pen to somebody else. If they see somebody who hasn't done the whiteboard work, they'll ask that person to do the whiteboard work this time. So their job is to facilitate. And then we also have another layer, which is really cool for us. These are, we call them ATAs, they're associate teaching assistants, and they're paying us to be in the classroom. They're getting credit for it, and those are primarily upper division students who want to teach the sciences, and they need teaching credit. So they'll pay for 3 credit hours, And we get the advantage of having them in the classroom. And we may end up with as many as 6 students and 1 faculty member for 75 students in the class. That's what I call flooding the zone. And it creates a really active and dynamic environment at a relatively small cost. The other innovation we had to go to in order to get scale, and we wrestled with this with the department chairs, if I have 1 lecturer and 450 students twice a week, that's the most efficient model I can imagine. I then say I need 6 active learning sections of 75 students each. That could be really expensive. So we ended up, initially we had instructors for each of those individual sections, and the price shot through the roof. And the department chairs picked up the phone and said, this is unsustainable. I don't have all that extra money to pay all those extra instructors for all those non-majors. So we ended up evolving to, as I was talking about it, there's 1 review session on Monday for all 450, and then the 6 active learning sections on Tuesday and Thursday are all with the same instructor. So she does the ACE 6 times every week. But she's got different students helping her out, so that keeps her stress level down and also helps to equalize the work. So that's our compromise on how to get to scale with this model. But we're having the same conversation with psychology and with economics, because they're also challenged by scale. When you start the process of transformation, think through all of the issues of facilities, because it may take 2 or 3 years to build out that classroom space. You cannot turn on classroom space overnight the way you can turn on an adaptive system. And I'll have faculty ask me these questions on day 1, because they want to know that their work is going to be practically used in 18 months. So if the facility is not there, when the train gets there, we have a wreck. And I have to start talking to our classroom scheduler. I have constant conversations with her. I have conversations with the university architect. We have people involved at all levels to see if we can't get ahead of this curve. And sometimes you even have to bond. Minnesota went out and spent $80 million and built an entire building just for active learning classrooms. That's why they host the conference, because they're so excited about it. But you may not have $80 million laying around to build a new building. So how do you creatively improvise? And these are people who are typically outside of our conversations about course development. They are ancillary. Now they are critical. Now they're primary. So got to go all the way to the end. Think, what are we going to be doing 2 years from now? What do we need done for fall of 18? I'm already talking about fall of 18. It drives me nuts sometimes, because I have to start thinking, what do I need in August of 2018? And then I have to reverse engineer that whole process. I'll talk a little bit about these indicators. I describe them as micro and macro. I've talked about these already, the macro ones, persistence, performance, satisfaction, and financials. We measure them constantly. We do student focus groups. We encourage the vendors to do student focus groups. We debrief with the faculty. During a semester, I meet every week with the faculty for a course. We're just in constant contact, because we need to keep our finger on the pulse of these factors. If something goes off, we want to know about it before the end of the semester. And in some cases, we can correct right there. In other cases, we have to wait till the end of the semester. But we also look at the money, because when you think through what is the ultimate measure, it's going to be student success at an efficient financial value. The legislature's watching us, the parents are watching us, the students are watching us. Every time they write a tuition check, they get worried. So we have to be cognizant of that. And then on the micro level, it's within these adaptive systems that you get the micro data. How do they do on that quiz? Which student needs help? So those are also almost on a daily basis in order to keep that ball rolling. On the micro level, the best case scenario is where the faculty member, and I talked a little bit about this, has a set of intervention strategies available to her. So if the student is identified as struggling, she can reach out and immediately help that student get back on track. That's what you have to think through on the micro level when you get into it. I have built a model that helps me organize my thoughts when I start on one of these endeavors. For every class, I start thinking about it at the most general level. What's my strategy? So we have a mission statement. One of the elements is enable student success. I feel fortunate to work in an organization where they try to be very transparent and have published lots and lots of really good descriptions of what we're trying to do and why we're trying to do it. So enable student success is on that list. I tag every one of my efforts to that and say, that's what we're doing. And then I meet with my leadership team every 2 weeks. I've got a vice provost, a couple of associate deans, the chief technology officer, and our chief design officer at the university. So those folks help me define the objectives, and these are the ones that surfaced as most important, but we also want to measure them. So when we talk about critical thinking skills, well, we do the applied concept exercise in every class. What is an objective if you don't have an implementation strategy and a way to measure it? It's meaningless. So for us, we say that the way we're going to build critical thinking skills is to do the ACEs. We want 90% of the students to get C or better. And I can measure that. Every semester, I get the data set out of PeopleSoft, and I compile it, and I share it with all the faculty, and I share it with all of my leadership team. We need to get to that level. If we're going to get to 90% freshman retention, it has to start in these general education courses. So the retention, this is our 90% rollover. That's the interim step. I can look at that. Are they coming back? Are they dropping out? After this algebra experience in the fall, in December, I can look and see who's re-enrolled for spring. And if the number looks like it's dropping way down, do we need to change something for spring? And then instructor insight. We don't want to have to wait 4, 5, 6 weeks to figure out that there's a student struggling. We have 2 academic status reports, and we want to be ahead of that curve. We want to be able to look, maybe even not in week 2, but week 1 going forward, or even day 2 in some cases. Because we know that that is the critical hour. That's the golden hour for us. Is a student checking in mentally to the class? And then once they're hooked, are they participating in the learning process? If they're just kind of floating along for the first couple weeks, then at the first sign of trouble, they bail out. It's too late to drop the class, so it goes as a W. We only have about a 7-day window for drop add, and then everything else gets a W, which is frustrating. Because we know sometimes students run into trouble and they realize they've taken on too much, but it hurts us, so we try to get to them as early as possible. I encourage you to think through that type of analysis and put that as your front page on the starting conversation. With every new faculty member that I meet with, that's my starting page. That's that, and I follow that with Bloom's Triangle to say, here we start with these big ideas, and then here's how we're going to try to do that. I mentioned this yesterday. I'll just go through it very quickly. The 2 down here, student course evaluations actually improved for us, so we were really excited about that. And then I had the most wonderful experience. 2 different faculty members came up to me after they had gone through the active learning process and said, I'm never going to lecture again. One of them was 70 years old, had been lecturing for 35 years, and said, I wish I had known this 35 years ago. So he was a true inspiration, because the old dog new tricks thing was just shot out of the water. He said, he taught me a whole bunch of new things that he can use for future processes. Now he goes all over the world and does active learning. He's on a consulting gig. So he goes to the Amazon and teaches Peruvian teachers how to do active learning. So he went on a jag and figured out how to create a whole industry around it. And then financially, so here's the hard part. In my experience, we have financial costs and economic benefits. For those who are into finance, these are 2 different balance sheets. The cost we see, I need an instructor, I need a TA, I need all these costs, I need a new room, that's a $3 million investment, I can count all that. But how do you value the student success? That's an economic equation. That's where we look at it practically and say, if they repeat, they cost us X amount of money. It's about 50%, actually much less than that now, of our budget comes from the state funding. So when we look at the value of repeating or not repeating, you can actually calculate that number. We save the state X amount of money if the student successfully completes the first semester. If you're doing all those calculations or hiring somebody to do them, then I would encourage you to share that information, but oftentimes it's confusing because the economics aren't always as clear as the financials. So everyone sees the upfront cost. But we do save money when they don't repeat the course. And that is an actual savings to the university. And then we are spending more money on instructors. There's a constant fear. I was at a presentation for accounting professors last week, and the first question was, are these systems going to replace us as teachers? And I said, that's the boogeyman, and that is not true. It's not going to happen. We actually are spending more money on putting more instructors into the classroom because the model is much more active and much more interactive. So I think we will need more, better instructors going forward to support this. We just have to figure out how to pay for everybody, keep everybody happy. You saw this one, so I won't spend any time on that. That's the outcome. On the student side, we do the surveys. So this was a survey instrument we did and asked, would you like to have a system for other courses? We hear this in the focus groups too. It's oftentimes they'll just spontaneously say, I wish I had this in my other courses because it really helped. So it's very encouraging when you're doing a debrief and they come up with those high numbers of success. Rio Salado did a survey after they ran their project, and they got tremendous support. They were doing grant peers on an adaptive learning system grant. So their debrief on English, which was interesting because we were doing hard sciences, they were doing English and using an adaptive system there, and the students liked that a lot. And then here's the cost. I'm going to put all these up so talk through them. Constructing. I set aside $100,000 to build a class in my head. 50,000 staff time and 50,000 faculty additional income. If I have to buy out a portion of their time, then that money needs to go to the department, and the department can then hire somebody else to teach the teaching load. If I have to pay them supplemental income, which we often do over the summer, to keep them engaged in the process so that the systems are ready for August, we'll do that. We try to think about this as an investment and not just additional cost. Because what we're building is a culture of active learning within the larger framework of the university. Configuration, a tenth of the cost. It's just all there. And the trade-off, obviously, is satisfaction. If you can live with what the vendor has, then bless your soul, because that's great. Keep moving. Work on the applied concept exercises. There's plenty of other things to do. It doesn't all have to be about the adaptive system. But you've got to keep all those pieces moving forward. And in terms of student costs, we're getting fees from the vendors between $35 and $100. What we'll often do is, in order to ensure 100% compliance so the students don't not buy the system, we will incorporate it as a material fee in the cost of the class. So they'll see a $50 adaptive system fee on there, and then we pay the vendor. Because we know that they need to get in day one. This is not like a textbook they can go get a reserve copy out of the library, or they can borrow one from their roommate, or they can get one off of Amazon. It doesn't exist outside of the system. So you have to think about that. How do you ensure 100% access on day one? And actually, day minus three, zero minus three, because they start before the class even starts, they start logging into the system. We set that up as an LTI connection from our LMS. For those who are familiar with that, that's single sign-on. So the students don't have to do anything. They don't even have to have a password. They don't even know they're going to another system sometimes. They just click on the link in Canvas, and it opens up Acrobatic, or it opens up Cogbooks, and they start working. And then we get all that data back as gradebook entries back into the system. And then faculty training, it's continuous. Even the math faculty have been at this for 6 years, and they still get together for a full day before the start of every semester to share best practices and to exchange their latest experiences, because they find value in that. There's a tremendous amount of learning that goes on in these processes, and we have to capture that. So for them, the day before the start of the semester, they all get together, they've got a pretty good agenda, they're self-managing now, they do all of it. They organize themselves and they come together and talk about it. And then they also will bring the new faculty members in at that point and teach them all the techniques. So that's an important part of the acculturation process. The new faculty members who haven't been through it before get exposure to their colleagues and know who to call. And when they're in week two and they're struggling and they can't figure out how to do a report or how to email 50 students at one time, they know who to call because they've got their peer mentors right there in the room. So that's really important. And if you need to reach me, you can always do that through email or through the folks who organize the event here. I'm always happy to continue the conversation. As it started yesterday, I said, welcome to the community of practice. You are now fully immersed in the conversation. I hope that this stimulates the conversation here and back at your institutions for those who've traveled to University of Florida. And I think that we're going to climb that curve together over the next 2 or 3 years. The vendors are going to continue to improve. You're going to get some exposure to it. You're going to talk to your colleagues at other universities, and it's going to grow even more. I expect that the next decade is really the golden era of educational technology. We are in a time when everything is moving at the same time. Everything is transforming. So we need to take advantage of it.
I did my homework. You told us to ask questions. So okay. Two things that I'm still kind of up in the air about. What would prevent, Florida's at a very good state economically right now, and nobody's really shaking our tree down, but what happens when we go into that downturn and the best chemistry course out there is now going to be unilaterally used at every institution, which I do believe there would be less professors then? That's one. And who owns the intellectual property rights? The university, the book company, and then as we continue to donate our information to the big system, what prevents them from becoming a public or a professional college that actually sells it to the students, possibly for cheaper than we can with our infrastructure?
So let me start with the intellectual property issue. When we pay a professor to do something, then the intellectual property is owned by the university, and they sign an agreement for that, so it's very clear up front. If we're paying you to do the video or we're paying you to write something, then we own that. They have the right of use, which means that if they go to another institution, they can take it with them and use it in their course. They just can't relicense it out again. On the downturn slash sort of transformational process, I've heard this a couple times where we used to do that until the recession hit, and then we had to go back to large lectures. So it's always a risk. And I think that's part of why the cultural development process is important, because we will find that the efficiency will come back as the dominant factor. At some point, there's going to be that same economic equation. So building this into the culture is important in terms of the teaching assistants and the next generation of doctoral students coming through, and then in the faculty that have been doing it, how do you integrate this into the normal experience instead of being the exception? Right now it's the exception, and so that's a transformative piece. And then in terms of the material being in the public domain or with the vendors, there's actually a firewall for us. The folks at Alex can't use our videos in other instances of Alex, so there's that barrier. But you should be clear in your contracts when you're dealing with the vendors what the intellectual property rules are. We have a whole section in our contract about that, and it's very clear about who owns what. And they have their intellectual property, so they're interested in defending their interests as well. But you have to be clear. And, oh, a couple more, yeah.
I have a question about assessment. So with active learning, with that chart that you had where the students go with active learning processes and then a lab, an exam, has there been any disconnect between the assessment and the active learning process?
We still use a lot of the same kinds of assessments we used before when we had the large lecture model, so we still have 4 exams. But in the active learning assessment, we often will do some type of handout within the group that they have to work on so that we can get that back as another way to assess their activity. And in the case of the group work, the students have to sign off to say that everyone participated in the conversation. So you have to think about that creatively. Make sure that you're actually measuring that group dynamic and see if there's value there. Students do not like to be graded on group work because of the free rider problem. So I like to think that the best model is you work as a group, but you evaluate individually. That way, each individual feels like they don't get penalized for the person who wants to just sit there on social media and ignore everybody else. But it's always a challenge. There are lots of good books and lots of good learning science on measuring the active learning outcomes as well.
I've heard the comment several times, I'm never going to lecture again, but what I see in a lot of flipped classroom scenarios is you're still lecturing, you're just videotaping it, and they're doing it on their own time, which is great. Anytime you can make them work outside of class. But I think that's a false pretense saying I'm never lecturing again. You're still delivering the information. Your platform's just different. Is that right?
Yeah. And it, you know, the good thing about it is that you get feedback on those lectures that you wouldn't get. So on the video lectures, we actually can capture likes, and students are voting them up and down. And that's helpful because a faculty member may assume that a particular lesson is well communicated, and then the students say, no, we're confused. So it works both ways. But you're right, we capture it for as long as it's relevant. And they all update them. We'll find, even though we have an entire suite of lessons on algebra, every couple of years they want to go back in the studio and update things. And that's good. That's a healthy process. Oh, got one more.
Oh, thank you very much. I have a question, especially regarding online learning. And for the cost kind of slides that shown there, and also before we discussed that there is this kind of infrastructure needing to implement the active learning. So is there a way or some thinking of alternative online, and especially if the course is based on online teaching too?
No, and that's a huge gap in our technology portfolio right now. There's the piece that we do so well face-to-face in terms of critical thinking and problem solving is completely missing in the online space. Discussion boards are woefully inadequate at this, and one of the things I'd love to see a vendor develop is a mechanism for some type of problem solving engagement online that is asynchronous, because we know that the students are in different places and different schedules, and it's hard to get everybody together, and we hear complaints, but this person didn't show up, and some way to integrate the lesson and the process of active learning without having everybody in the same spot. So huge problem right now, huge gap in our pedagogy online, I think. Any good ideas in the room would be welcome. Great, well thank you again.